In today's video, we're going to check out some more creepy TikTok conspiracies. Let's get into it.
You ever heard that old story that Eisenhower made a deal with the aliens to abduct people from the national parks in the United States, and that's why we have all these suspicious as shit disappearances from the national parks? I have too, and I kind of believe it, because look, it looks like national parks tend to be a UFO hotspot for the past 23 years. Why is that? But I'm not done. And then when you lay the missing people in national parks map on top of the UFO sighting map, it just becomes so much more clear, right? And then to top it all off, when people go missing under suspicious circumstances in the national park, a lot of times they leave behind no physical evidence, not even a trail for the dog to pick up on. And then if they are found, many are found with no shoes and no socks, but clean feet. And again, if they are found, they are usually found 10 to hundreds of miles away from where they started or where they went missing from. And if they're alive, they have no memory of how they got there or what happened to them. A perfect example of this really scary phenomenon is baby Jared. He went missing when he was 3 years old from a national park while he was on a hike with his church group. This is what was found of him 4 years later. No body, nothing else, just this. His shoes look like they're still in perfect condition. His hoodie and his pants were turned inside out, and you can see that wildlife had taken stuff off of his pants. So there's two schools of thought on baby Jared: abduction or mountain lion. What do you think?
That's actually something I never thought of, is all the sightings in all the different national parks and stuff. It also kind of makes me wonder, maybe there's traffickers out there that are kidnapping people and sending them somewhere else. That's something to take into consideration as well. But that being said, have any of you guys experienced any national parks? What national parks are around your area? And if you've been there, have you ever witnessed any UFO sightings?
No one's ever talked about this one. In 2017, a team of Russian scientists went to southern Italy with the express purpose of sending messages to shamans in the past. These stone structures are known as nuraghe. It's widely accepted that these were used by local shamans. The Russian team used a special device known as a Kozarev mirror, and they had their meditators focus on sending pictograms to the past within the nuraghe. And later, those same pictograms were found in the rock art from the local museum. So did the Russians find a way to link the past and the present?
Recently, I've been actually finding some videos about the shamans of the past and all these different odd structures that have like little windows in them. It does make me wonder if those little structures were actually used to communicate with other people across the world in that time. Again, this could be some form of ancient technology that we're missing, whether it's in oneself or there's physically technology somewhere hidden that we just haven't found yet. Everything across the world kinda is similar. Like, how do you know to build a pyramid and across the whole world there's another civilization building pyramids almost the same? You would think that there's some kind of communication going on back and forth, you know? It's a pretty interesting theory.
So when your things rearrange itself to look like something, an entity, a person, a demon, an animal, and it catches your attention, that's acknowledgement. So what you want to do in that situation is look away, don't think about it, don't give it energy.
I do apologize, but if I've seen a bag that looked like a little child standing by my door, and I know that I do not have a child standing by that door, and it's just a bag, I'm throwing that bag away.
So you know that the Met Gala is a charity event, right? So I was curious, what is this charity for? Where is all this money going? So I googled it. It says the beneficiary is the Metropolitan Museum of Art's Costume Institute. So the beneficiary is the costume department of the Met. So originally, this whole Met Gala started as a $50 event. And you know the tickets are $75,000 each. And then it says the minimum cost at the table is $350,000. And it says in this article that they make more than the Super Bowl. The media value of the Met Gala is $543 million because they don't just make money off of tickets for their tables and their entrance fees or whatever it is. They also give away or sell media rights. They even sold live stream ad spaces to the event for $1 million each. $543 million. higher than the Super Bowl.
That's so ridiculous to me. My mind is kind of blown. That's so much money over an event that's not even supporting a better cause. Like, hey, all for trying to keep your clothes, your costumes in good condition, sure, I'm sure they cost a lot of money. But that's a lot of money going into that business. And I doubt that it's going back out into the world. And on top of that, I'm sure for everyone that pays that money to get into that event, probably writes it off on their taxes. That is so wild to me.
Y'all have been asking about the blob. I went really deep into it. Here's what I found. This is Brazil right now. So yet again, on the 6th of May, we had this anomaly. This is the third time we've had this anomaly. And it's always coming from the same exact place. But I found something really freaky. I'll show you in just a little bit. But you can actually see in this map how it's dispersing waves this way, or what makes the radar appear to be waves towards, you know, Cape Town and all these things. Now, there's a lot of boats going up and down that route, and they aren't seeing anything. So last night, I took a trip on Google Earth to the island where all this stuff is originating. Look at this right here. It looks like two doorways. That does not look like natural. So I'm sitting here wondering, is this island really like a hollowed out piece of land where things are happening on the inside of it? By the way, if you want to look at it, this island is called Bovet Island, and it's a super remote island close to Antarctica. Now check this out. This is where the blobs are originating. I'm about to show you a really big one that comes from somewhere else in a minute. But notice how it goes up. What's this right here? This is Brazil. This is Brazil right now. This is also Brazil right now. This is also Brazil right now. Yeah, that's a horse on the roof. Now, Brazil is under some of the worst flooding in history, but we can see some of it started in the 8th of April. You know, when the blob first caught mainstream attention. But now we have this May 6th blob, and we can see all this destruction in Brazil. Brazil. And right now, Brazil is saying it's going to get a whole lot worse. So with these anomalies being shown, I was like, well, what's going to happen according to their model in the future? Oh my goodness. On the 12th, we are seeing this. Look at these waves. 50, 60, 80, 70 foot coming right from Antarctica near where the island is, but straight up coming right off the coast of Antarctica. Why is it calling for this? Look at this. 80 foot, 90 foot. This is unheard of. To me, this has to be frequency. Boom. Just like that. Gone. Gone. Just like that. It goes from this to boom. It's gone. That's not normal. That's not how things dissipate. My opinion is I believe these blobs are frequency and energy because the boats aren't seeing them, but we are seeing natural disasters around the areas and the waves pointing towards where they're going. I also put on satellite layer, weather layer, and temperature layer, and none of them picked up anything while this or the other one was going on. So mark down May 12th on your calendar and let's see what happens.
I am so sorry, and I hope the best for everyone that's out there in Brazil. I think that is absolutely awful. I am extremely curious about this anomaly. I've done a little bit of research on Google, and the only thing that I can find out about it that makes sort of realistic sense, if it's not some kind of weapon or some kind of governmental device that's doing this. Apparently in this area, it's called the South Atlantic Anomaly. You can Google this. It's a study that was taken place in 2018. And this is according to what I've seen online. Don't hold me to it. This is just going to be a super rough explanation of what it could possibly be. But with the Van Allen belt around the world, there is what's called radiation belts. And apparently, in the South Atlantic, there is a very low ride of that Van Allen belt, and it's causing this anomaly. Again, you can look this up online. It's called the South Atlantic Anomaly. I'm not 100% sure if it is referencing this specific anomaly, but it does seem to match. So let me know your guys' thoughts on this. And again, I hope the best for the people that are in Brazil suffering through this. Hey, if you haven't done so already, go ahead and like the video and subscribe to the channel. I only ask once per video, and I make a video like this almost every day. And to everyone that's subscribed, thank you so much for being a part of the channel. And to the people that are not subscribed, I still appreciate you nonetheless. Thank you for watching. And don't forget, if you want to be a part of Questions for DK, where I answer personal questions, questions about conspiracy theories, or theories in general, leave a comment starting with question for DK so that I can find it in the YouTube search results and answer those questions in a future video. And recently I was asked when I'll be uploading one of those questions for DK because I don't do it consistently. I don't really know when I'm going to do it. It's kind of when I feel like I have enough questions because I answer about 10 questions on the videos. And I have plenty of questions, but I'm just letting it build a while. And I'll let you know at the end of these midsections when I'll have a question for DK at the end of the video.
On March 11th, 2011, a mysterious book suddenly appeared online. It was called The Book of Aquarius. And this is what was written on the first page. The age of secrets is over. There's no need for mystical language or metaphor. This book contains no hidden meaning or codes. Everything is stated plainly and directly.
So what the hell does this mean?
Well, this means anyone who wanted to create the Philosopher's Stone now has a recipe to follow, just like a cookbook. The Book of Aquarius looked legit. It's 165 pages and references 49 different alchemical texts that span 1,000 years. It's a long, difficult process, but anyone with the time and patience could do it. And some people did. And what's most amazing about the recipe for the Philosopher's Stone is that it's only one ingredient. And we all have it in us. Well, the one ingredient is,
what?
Urine.
Okay.
Some of the greatest minds in history have tried to find the secret of the Philosopher's Stone. When the Book of Aquarius appeared on an online forum in 2011, the anonymous author encouraged everyone to spread it online for free. He wrote, "The purpose of this book is to release one particular secret, which has been kept hidden for the last 12,000 years. The Book of Aquarius contained easy-to-understand, step-by-step instructions for how to create the Philosopher's Stone, which, if created properly, would grant you eternal life. The author of the book said that all the old alchemy texts using confusing metaphors and symbolism was actually done intentionally. This was an early disinformation campaign, a way to keep the recipe secret, but still make it accessible to alchemists who knew how to decipher the text. And when the Book of Aquarius was posted to an online forum, it was ridiculed at first. There was no way you could achieve immortality with pee, but throughout history, alchemists actually used urine all the time. The 16th century Swiss alchemist Paracelsus claimed that life essence was in blood, in hair, sweat, and human waste. The Book of Aquarius says that the Philosopher's Stone is this life energy, concentrated and purified. This is the same energy you take in when you breathe, when you eat and drink. It's the energy that powers all forms of life, so it makes sense that it would be found in urine. Ancient alchemists knew this as well. But now with the Book of Aquarius hitting the web, all the secret symbolism and oaths of secrecy were useless. The Book of Aquarius gave specific step-by-step instructions on how to store, boil, distill, ferment, and purify urine. It would take months or even years, but eventually a stone would start to form. It was all in the book. How to do it, what the results should look like, what the process smells like. The process for extracting your life energy required patience. Even if you did everything correctly, it would take between 3 and 8 years to finish the work and make a stone. And that's assuming you kept your materials free from contamination, controlled the temperature, and used the correct equipment at the correct phase of production. A lot could go wrong. Yet a small but determined group of people were giving it their best shot. The recipe for creating the stone had two major parts. First, you had to repeatedly distill the urine and continually remove the densest particles. Next, you do it all again, but this time remove the lightest particles, which would be a form of salt. This first part would ideally take 3 months, but could often take up to a year. In the second part of the recipe, you combine the salt with the distilled urine and put it on a low and continuous heat. You do that for over a year until it putrefies and turns black. You keep heating the black stuff and eventually it turns white. And then you turn up the heat a little bit more and the stone turns red. And then you're pretty much ready to go. The Book of Aquarius is probably not a hoax, but a book written by a passionate individual who honestly believes they're sharing the secret to creating a Philosopher's Stone.
We tinkle?
Yep. There's actually a well-documented case of an alchemist attempting to create the Philosopher's Stone from urine. In 1669, German alchemist Hennig Brandt dedicated years of his life to creating the stone. He was convinced urine was the way to do it, and he did everything that the Book of Aquarius says to do. Now, after boiling and distilling 1,500 gallons of his essence, he ended up with a white, waxy substance that actually glowed in the dark.
He made the stone?
No, he accidentally discovered phosphorus. Now, to a 17th century alchemist, this must have been amazing. Here was a substance that was the product of the human body that was glowing with a life force. Now, Braun kept the recipe secret while he tried to create gold, but when he couldn't get that to work, he sold the recipe to another alchemist. As for living forever, well, it's been reported that Hennig Braun did die, but nobody knows exactly when. Now, of course, legend says that he faked his death and, like Nicholas Flamel, is still alive today. Now, that makes sense to me. If I created the Philosopher's Stone, I don't think I'd ever tell. Would you?
That's pretty cool. I didn't really know what the Philosopher's Stone was truly. I didn't know it was for immortality. The one thing, though, like, what do you do to obtain the immortality after you create the stone? What happens? Do you eat the stone? Do you have to, like, shove it up your butt? Do you just hold on to it forever? What do you do to maintain immortality? Or in the process of creating the stone, you just magically encase your essence into the stone so you never age? I guess I just don't understand how you become immortal. So anyone that has an idea, let me know in the comments, because it has to be more than just making pea stones, you know?
I've been in rooms at the top of the top, which albums are prayed over demonically. Music is prayed over demonically. That goes out to the world, goes out to the radio stations, goes out to the public. And when you see that stuff and know that stuff, it's frightening.
What do you mean by that, Shane, prayed over demonically?
So rituals, ceremonies, everything to bring, to give light to the devil, to Satan. It's a satanic music industry. That's majority of what it is.
Do you mean figuratively, or do you mean literally you've been in?
Literally, yes.
And
figuratively.
Can you share what those albums were? Were they your albums?
No, weren't our albums. No, they were not Boyzone albums. So that's what I mean by not every music is that, but it was on the stepping stone to that. So you're going back to the 1993s into 2000s, and then, if you look at what the music is today, the industry is today, for all your Sam Smiths to your Dojo Cats to your Beyoncés to, they are so demonic, it's unbelievable.
And you know how weird that's got to be? You get a phone call, you're like, yeah, well, we're about to sign this record deal, come up to the 50th floor. And you go up to the 50th floor, and next thing you know, everyone's in cloaks and capes and they're hovering over a record, and it's just like, I'm gonna get out of here now. It would probably make someone that's not really a believer in religion really question faith at that point.
I knew something wasn't right about that pastor getting on stage claiming that his wife unalived herself by suicide. And I have been digging into her page, his page, and the family page. And when I tell you the secrets are deep and very sinister, you guys need to hear this. This South Carolina pastor got on a stage in front of his entire congregation and told them that he was going to share news with them. And the news was that his wife was gone. After doing a whole sermon, he asked his congregation not to spread the information after leaving out of the service and said that she was mentally unwell and that as of the night prior, she unalived herself. The New York Post released an article that says South Carolina pastor husband claims wife died of suicide as family urges police to deeply investigate her death. So that is just what's going on at the surface level. And I'm going to show you the video of the pastor claiming that she unalived herself. But then I want to show you what I came up with and what I discovered.
Announcement. And after the announcement, I'm going to ask that you leave church quietly and don't talk about the announcement here in the building. Please, if you can, so y'all can stand to your feet. Before I make the announcement, I also want to say that my request to you is that you will continue to come to church and serve and give for the next, you know, little bit. Because I'm taking a little bit of a break, and I don't want to have to worry about the church. My break may be a few days, a few weeks, I don't know. I got a call late last night. My wife has passed away. And yeah, it was self-induced, and it was up in North Carolina. And we're going to have a funeral for her next Sunday here at 3 p.m. And so it's all I can, I'm just kind of going on adrenaline right now. So y'all pray for me and my kids and everybody. And she wasn't, y'all knew that she wasn't well mentally. and that she needed medicine that was hard to get to her. And so I'm sure there'll be more details to come. But,
I want to call attention to the fact that that man didn't shed one tear. He didn't wince once. And let's get into why I believe he is lying. Just 24 hours before her passing, Mika served her husband, that pastor, with divorce papers. She also was trying to get away from him as he was a known abuser and he had been grooming her since she was 14. And these posts come from her family and friends that are sharing the hashtag Justice for Mika on Facebook. And this is the post that I came across from one day ago. And it says, I'm typically not one to just share info without a ton of verifiable facts. But in this case, a young lady has lost her life. And at least at bare minimum, an investigation needs to be started immediately. I know this preacher. We went to the same school growing up. And I know his father to be wrought with controversy and criminal activity over the years. The apple does not fall far from the tree most of the time. And then he goes on to talk about Mika and what she experienced with the pastor. She said the pastor and his young wife he had groomed since she was 14 had been separated for a month or so and were in the process of going through with a divorce. Many people close to Mika know that she was suffering from abuse and control in her marriage. She tells her family that she was not experiencing any self-harm ideation that was fearful for her life due to outside circumstances, which is documented in recent public videos, which is the video I showed you. Well, I'm going to show you. She then went on to say some person was slashing her tires, stalking her, and just overall being aggressive towards her to the point where she got a no contact order against this person and was filed for divorce 4 days before her death by a supposed self-inflicted gunshot wound. She passed away late Saturday at the age of 30, and the abuser husband was no problem preaching, not even 24 hours later, avoids the topic. You guys, this is really crazy. Avoids the topic until the end of while, cracking jokes and calling himself charming and handsome during the service. I would put the video of Mika on here, but this video has gotten too long, so I will post another video where Mika was saying that she was going through something really tough and she could not be around a lot of people as she didn't feel safe. I mean, that would be explained by her tires being slashed. She was being stalked, and it looks like the same person who was doing that was her husband.
Well, I don't want to put a bad name on someone that may be innocent, but if that's the case, that is horrible. And rest in peace to the person that took their life, because if they were really suffering with mental problems, that's a horrible life to live, especially if they couldn't be properly treated for it. And as far as the preacher, she said that he didn't really wince or shed a tear, but he did sound pretty sad. He sounded pretty shaken by it. And honestly, I really don't know. I've never heard of this before this video, so this is the first time for me hearing about it. But hopefully there will be a follow-up. Maybe there will be a little bit more insight of the situation to either prove his innocence or if he's guilty. So let's stay tuned for that.
You've been talking about a famine coming.
Because pandemic, famine, and war, they go together. They're a triangle. As you know, today we have a lot more technology than we had in the past. I mean, that's to state the obvious. And one of those is nitrogenous fertilizers. They used to use guano, bird guano. War is fought over guano, right? Because that was the original nitrogenous fertilizer. BASF is this is really important. So I hope everybody's paying attention because this is all going to come together. Mm-hmm. The BASF plant on the Rhine River dumps out at Rotterdam. They started making the nitrogenous fertilizers there in 1914. So other companies started to make nitrogenous fertilizers. A huge component of these nitrogenous fertilizers, though, is natural gas because you need that hydrogen, right? And so we're in the plant at BASF in Ludwigshafen, Germany. I said to the man that was giving us a tour, what happens if Nord Stream gets interrupted? He said, BASF is dead. Well, it's not dead. Because shortly after that, months later, it was bubbling to the surface of the sea, right? Last March, I was in Netherlands again. And then I went to Groningen gas field. That's the biggest gas field in Europe is in Netherlands. I think they're going to close Groningen gas field. And people are like, you're crazy. They're not going to close that. They closed it. It's now closed. If I'm trying to put us into famine, I'm going to start turning off all those natural gas switches. I'm going to reduce the nitrogenous fertilizers. I found in a 1911 Encyclopedia Britannica, people can find this, And I went right to F for famine. I wanted to see what they were saying about it. It goes and it talks about, well, the big famines are probably over. There probably won't be any more big ones now because we have faster ships, bigger ships. But what they were wrong about was how evil man can be. Because the biggest famines have been man-made, like by Stalin and the Holodomor, like by Mao, by so many of these famines. The 1845 to 1854 famine in Ireland was not all about the fungus and the black potatoes, right? A lot of it was caused by the English cutting them off.
What do you advise people do to get ready for it?
One thing's for sure, it's not going to be easy. Everybody is going to have a different solution. But it's going to have to be community-based. One of the things retired military man told me started to arrange his community around his church. He started taking an inventory of everybody's skills, like roofs, you know how to do plumbing, you know how to do electric, whatever, right? So that way everybody knows who knows how to do what, and pulling them together as a community, working with radios, figuring out how to keep communication with each other and that sort of thing. But we have a predatory government. Another thing that I've noticed in famines, and this is important, is the governments always go after the farmers.
So for the people that are listening that we've just scared the hell out of with the famine, best thing is for them to build community.
Build community.
One of my favorite films is the film of the lunar module leaving the moon. So this is it. Now watch how this pulls up. Here it goes. It detaches. It's like... What is that?
We are perfectly tilting up with it in real time.
It's just
with the remote control from NASA with the radio delay that I suspect would be more like 12 seconds.
The panning is interesting, but you could put a timer on it. The thing looking so goofy, so crazy, like that thing is supposed to get off 1/6 Earth gravity and fly like that. How? What's it doing? It looks so fucking fake. It looks like it's being pulled by strings. Look, it might be real. I'm certainly not an astronaut. I don't know what I'm talking about. But if you had a guess, if you showed this to me and said, hey, do you think this is real or fake? And you didn't give me any context, I'd be like, what is this? A cheap science fiction movie? What is this? And then here it goes. Like, that's what? That's leaving a planet? How's it leaving? Is that some new space technology? Where's the fire coming out of the bottom of it? How's it doing that? I mean, it just looks fake. Are you scared of bugs?
Stop fighting.
It just keeps getting fucking close. Look at them all. Oh no, that fucking butterfly.
So this is from one day when I was vacuuming my room when I was living in Australia. And I vacuumed behind a cushion that was on my floor and sucked up a funnel web spider.
I'm not going to lie. The first part of this clip almost made me jump out of my chair. I do not like spiders. All the other bugs I can handle, but when it comes to a spider, nah, I'm all right.
Look at this over here, you guys. So this lady was outside with her daughter, and her daughter told her to look at the moon. Now, when they looked at the moon, they could only see one moon, but they noticed that the moon was extremely bright. So when she took out her camera, she was able to see two moons in the sky, y'all. This is in Utah. Check this out.
24, 10 p.m. in St. George, Utah. My daughter, Sam, texted me and told me to go out and look at the moon. It's a full moon tonight. I went and looked at it, and it looked totally normal, totally beautiful. I went to start taking pictures of it and noticed that there are two of them. Two moons. The one above is brighter. The one below looks normal. You cannot see this with the naked eye. You can only see it taking a picture or video, apparently.
I told y'all.
Using an iPhone 14 Pro.
And not all iPhones show it neither, y'all. But it looks like the Vitruvian Man. Look at that. And you see how it changes colors when you zoom in? It looks like the Vitruvian Man. It looks just like the Vitruvian Man, because it's like, where are we ever going to see this? You know what I'm saying? Because everything revolves around the sun. Everything is the sun. You know, the sun gives life to everything on the planet. So, of course, it would be talking about the sun. I mean, look at the sphere. You know what I'm saying? And then you see it over there in the moon and sometimes in the sun as well. What an amazing time to be alive, you guys.
When I, the MPs were taking me out down the hall, that's when she came out of the supply room with this towel over her face, and that's when she screamed, "Glenn, get out of here as fast as you can." And I met her, I kept calling, and I met her the next morning at the officers' club in a conference room, and that's when she gave me a little diagram of what they were going on, what they looked like. And it looks like what you see today, most of the little diagrams, you know, the four fragile fingers and the long arm, real short joint, the large eyes. She said the heads were almost completely demolished, but they could see. They only had two orifices. They didn't have earlobes. They had two ear canals. The mouth was only about 1 inch. And that's the way she described it to me. And I was with her till about 11:30 that day. And then at 3:30 that afternoon, her supervisor called and said, "Your friend has been transferred out." And I had a serial number and everything else, but I never have found her to this day. I've never made contact with her. So I'm sure, I think the best thing they did, she was going to join a convent, and I'd imagine they discharged her and let her go. It's a good place to keep somebody quiet. And he came up to me, and he was punching me on the shoulder, just lightly. I mean, he wasn't rough or anything. And he just said, "Look, mister, you don't go in and start any rumors and rustles. Nothing happened out here." And he said, "If you do, you know, it'd be real serious problems." And so I just, being as my character was at that time, I said, "I'm a civilian, you can go to hell." And that's where he said, "You may be the one going to hell." And then that's when he really told me, he said, "Somebody be picking your bones out of the sand if you do that."
The canal in Arizona already existed, and then they just decided to change it a little bit. They decided to make it go a little a different direction and reverse it, which is interesting because they also reversed Lake Michigan as well, made it flow back the opposite direction, which makes you think what it does to the water. So in Arizona, they actually had a canal already, and then they rebuilt another one and attached it to that canal, and that whole thing was already here. And it's interesting because I cannot find photos of Arizona that go back to like the 1800s and the 1900s. It's very hard to see any photos, but there's old world buildings in downtown Phoenix. The Chamber of Commerce is an old world building. The City Hall is an old world building. So all the same old world buildings that were in all the cities across the United States also exist in Phoenix. If you want to go through something, go on to Google or go on to archive.org or whatever website you want to go on to, and look up the original pictures of your town. And you'll see a lot of buildings that used to be there that have somehow vanished as well, too.
Oh boy, voice-to-skull technology. This is also in the foray of directed energy weapons. The ability to, let's just say, throw your voice into your head, or my voice into my head, or allowing algorithms that now they could blanket a whole geographical area and they can make everybody change their thoughts. If you find yourself where you have to make a decision about something, next thing you know, you catch yourself kind of having an argument in your head with your own voices. Well, the ability to add another one of your voices in there, but have it controlled by somebody else's microphone, so to say, is a very powerful tool. And I think this is a weapon of war. The Department of Defense recently started initiating protocols for their employees, their agents, to discuss Havana syndrome, Havana syndrome-like symptoms. And on that list is that their agents are hearing voices in their head, and this is what they're getting at. This is that technology. Next thing you know, you're trying to make a decision, but there's another Sean in your head that now is actually somebody else's control, and through the manipulation of that voice, they can push you in a direction by repetitive information being displayed in front of you, that they can learn your system, and they can learn to manipulate it on a personalized level.
I personally do think that mind control technology in this sense does exist. I do not think it's perfect to the point where they can just completely tell you what to do, but I do think that there's a lot of influence in today's society, whether it's advertisements, whether it's a phone listening to you and advertising to you, there's a lot of influence that's happening. So it wouldn't surprise me if there's some kind of subliminal sound wave or something that they're feeding us also that's making us potentially crave food, maybe sounds that make us want to watch certain videos or movies. There's probably all kinds of hidden technology out there that we're completely unaware of that they're testing on us.
They were celebrating her birthday when this happens. A woman named Jocelyn was with her family celebrating her birthday when suddenly, as she's getting ready to blow the candles, this happens.
Happy birthday.
Oh my god, she's making
a
wish.
How many years
is this?
Actually,
you
wish I'm
getting a girlfriend. There's a lot of millions in this
car.
What the heck? Who's
that? Who blew it out? It was R because he didn't wish out. Was it Carmen? That was weird. It was
a win.
Mi abuelita.
What win? Is that fucking?
There's
no win. Oh, yeah. The door would open.
What the heck? Who's that?
¿Qué miraron?
A ver, tu madre, ¿tú lo grabaste?
Pues yo no sé qué pasó.
¿Quién apagó la vela?
There's no win in here.
¿Quién apagó la vela?
¿Quién apagó la vela?
What the fuck?
Carmen,
did you blow it out? Was it you? No, she would have said if she blew it out.
The candles suddenly went out on their own, as if someone blew them. Jocelyn uploaded this haunting, inexplicable phenomenon to her social media page, with many questions left unanswered. Could it be a lingering spirit who also celebrated their birthday in that home? Let me know your thoughts.
Nah, I think she laughed those candles out. I think when she went to laugh, it just blew them out. But it could have been a ghost. But I'm pretty certain it was just from her laughing. Alright guys, I'm gonna go ahead and end this video here today. As always, if you enjoyed these clips that we played, links are in the description down below. And with that being said, have a good day.